Thank you very much. I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus, and ask that members take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber, when accessing or leaving your seat. The next item of business is a Scottish Liberal Democrat Party debate on Motion 24137 in the name of Willie Rennie on education. And can I invite members who wish to speak in this debate to press your request to speak buttons now, and I call on Willie Rennie to speak to and move the motion.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. At the heart of the recovery must be education. It's a great Liberal cause. School closures and remote learning were never going to be easy. But teachers, pupils and parents have worked flat out to make it work as very best that they can. It's been a time of great disruption and worry, and it's going to take time for education to bounce back. I want to focus on what children and young people really need. I think we should be making every hour spent in school count for more. More resources in every classroom. Cuts to additional support needs reversed. More supported study to help children work through problems and consolidate understanding. And if Primary 1 children aren't ready to start school in August, they should be guaranteed nursery funding, not a £4,500 bill that forces parents to make a decision that isn't in the best interests of the child. And it isn't about making children sit at desks for longer. It's about the quality of the experience. But what is clear is that Education Scotland and the SQA cannot be trusted with that critical job of helping the education system bounce back. These Scottish Government agencies have let hard-working teachers, pupils and parents down. You'd be hard-pressed to find many of them thanking their lucky stars for the help of Education Scotland and the SQA over the last year. Now remember, despite months of warnings, the SQA and John Swinney teamed up to create an exam system that crushed ambitions. They concocted an algorithm that actively penalised pupils from the poorest backgrounds. Teachers were cut out of that process by the SQA and told their pupil assessments couldn't be trusted. Before the pandemic, we all remember Education Scotland generating 20,000 pages of guidance on curriculum for excellence. It was impossible to navigate. But during this pandemic, they have gone to the other end of the scale, and for long periods were totally absent when people needed them most. The government will say remote learning was unprecedented, and it was. But that is when Education Scotland should have been leading with the support schools required. But they let people down in the first lockdown, and it wasn't much better in the second. The job of education recovery is too important to entrust to organisations that were on borrowed time before the pandemic struck. Because as my motion recalls, both organisations narrowly escaped reform back in 2017. As colleagues examined forensically on that day, Education Scotland is both responsible for what happens in the classroom and for inspecting its implementation. It's a fundamental conflict of interest that didn't work then, and it certainly does not work now. I want to re-establish the independence of the inspectorate. On the SQA, most importantly, we highlighted the total breakdown in trust between it and teachers, and that's only got worse. On that day in 2017, the SNP and the Green votes allowed these organisations to drift towards the pandemic without reform. Our definitive call for their overhaul was watered down and then sunk by John Swinney without trace. His amendment tries to do exactly the same again today. So I am pleased that the Greens are on board so we can make progress. And I do want to thank the Greens for their support today. The balance in education must change. Out should go centralised bureaucracies and their token teachers on committees. In must come an education system overseen by people with current and direct teaching experience. The teachers who have been bustling with good ideas through the pandemic and worked incredibly hard for their pupils. Let's get the experts back in charge. Parliament unanimously backed an independent OECD review last spring. It was to get to the bottom of diminishing subject choice and why other countries are overtaking ours. I suspect others here today will agree that we probably wouldn't have voted for that had the government laid bare its true plans. The Scottish Government have the first draft. They have timetabled in months to, I quote, provide comments. As Keir Bloomer, an architect of Curriculum for Excellence, told the Sunday Post, that is less than objective. And the OECD review is being advised and shaped by a Scottish practitioners forum. That sounds sensible, until you discover that Education Scotland and the SQA dominate that small group, the very bodies whose performance and policies are under the microscope. They aren't independent. They aren't practitioners. So what on earth are they doing on this advisory practitioners forum? Our Freedom of Information request found documents that state the group would be considering preliminary findings and supporting development of the report. The government should end the meddling and publish the report now so that people can judge the First Minister on her stated number one priority of education, and so that we can finally get on with helping Scottish education bounce back. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much. I now call on John Swinney to speak to and move amendment 24137.3.
Presiding Officer, the pandemic has presented enormous challenges for our education system and our young people. The cancellation of the examination diets and the move to remote learning have been unprecedented, but they were sadly required. The health, well-being and learning of our young people have been a priority throughout. And while I do not claim that we have got everything right, we have made judgments in the most testing of circumstances. Those judgments are about keeping our young people and staff safe, maintaining learning and the benefits that come from teaching, and ensuring young people's life chances are not negatively impacted. As we've charted our way through the pandemic, teachers, support staff and other professionals in our schools, local authorities, national agencies, regional collaboratives and other bodies have been working day in and day out with dedication, commitment and professionalism to support our young people. Their efforts are a credit to our education system and to our country. And it serves neither the country nor our children and young people to attack the contribution of some of those staff in Education Scotland and the Scottish Qualifications Authority for their efforts. My amendment removes from this motion the gratuitous and unfounded criticism of the public servants in Education Scotland and the SQA, who have worked hard alongside local authority and school staff and many others to ensure continuity of education for children and young people. I thank them for their efforts. Presiding Officer, very strong support has been provided across the system, a system working in collaboration in the face of the threats to education that COVID presents. Education Scotland and the SQA have been central to those efforts. Throughout the pandemic, Education Scotland has provided substantial support to learners, teachers and parents. The National e-Learning Offer provides live, recorded and supported learning resources. Professional learning and support for teaching remotely is available, including for wellbeing and wider professional learning. Targeted work takes place with local authorities and schools to support the system on the ground. For more than a decade before the pandemic, Education Scotland has been delivering the GLOW national online learning platform. This foresight meant that we had the tools in place to move to remote learning and allow the development of online content offers, including eSchool and the West Partnerships Online School. Last week, GLOW saw over 366,000 users logging in over 2.4 million times. To support the quality of remote learning delivery, Education Scotland has undertaken 5 national review reports since schools returned in January. These show clear evidence that schools have learned from the previous lockdown and are continuing to improve their remote learning offer. Mr Rennie mentioned not one single one of these pieces of contribution to the education system by Education Scotland. Like Education Scotland, the SQA remains absolutely committed to delivering for learners in Scotland. The SQA has worked with the rest of the education system to ensure that learners get the results they've worked hard for while maintaining the credibility and standards of the qualifications, a point which I think Members of Parliament have generally agreed upon as being important over the years. Certification has been a very difficult task for all the nations of the United Kingdom, a task that we did not get right for all at the first attempt last year. That was why I apologised to learners and why I commissioned Professor Priestley to review events to ensure we learned and made improvements. The SQA has engaged widely with stakeholders, particularly leading partners in the co-design of the alternative certification model for this year and establishing a learner panel to help inform its decisions. They consulted widely on modifications to courses and have published 116 subject-specific guidance documents, reducing evidence requirements while preserving the validity and the public confidence in qualifications. They've also published 134 individual assessment resources to support teachers and lecturers in their assessment activity. These steps have been significant in making good progress in the development of the certification model for 2020-21, with further details announced yesterday by the National Qualifications 2021 Group, providing greater certainty to the system. The support that has been provided to our children and young people to ensure that they can continue to learn and develop is down to the hard work and commitment of the professionals in our schools and elsewhere in the system, including in our national agencies. All of them deserve thanks and recognition from this Parliament for their resilience and their flexibility, for the contribution that they continue to make, and I don't think they deserve the gratuitous terminology that's in the Liberal Democrat motion today. A contribution that extends well beyond the response to the pandemic has been made by all of these different players and includes important work on the future of Scottish education, such as the independent review of Scotland's curriculum. The OECD review is looking at many aspects of the implementation of Scotland's curriculum, including the roles and responsibilities of national agencies in providing support and guidance in relation to the curriculum. The government is always open to considering how best these arrangements should be designed. The review has been taken forward following OECD methodology and clear guidelines. They will share draft findings from that work in March, with a final report published in June, as I outlined to Parliament last April. The OECD is clear that taking into account the current stage of the progress and past experience conducting such reviews, the report will be finalised and is expected to be ready for publication in June 2021. I look forward to considering the recommendations from the review. I'm afraid I've got to draw my remarks to a close. I look forward to considering the recommendations from the review when it is fully concluded. This will be important as we emerge from the pandemic and we maintain a relentless pursuit of excellence and equity in education in Scotland. That is the key priority of the Scottish Government, pre-COVID and post-COVID, and it is what we will devote our efforts to ensure is the case, to provide the best future and the best opportunity for the learners of Scotland. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Jamie Green to speak to and move amendment 24137.1.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, Punxsutawney Phil is paraded every February to curious spectators. If he sees his own shadow, he retreats, and they are destined to more wintry gloom. If he does not, spring arrives and brings about a change in the air, and wouldn't that be nice? Groundhog Day, however, is where it all goes very wrong. History repeats itself, and there's nothing anyone can do about it. Sounds like the plot of a movie. Well, Mr. Swinney is our very own Phil Connors, trapped in the endless gloom of this endless loop. And that, Presiding Officer, sums up today's debate. I might be new to the education brief, Presiding Officer, but my goodness, haven't we been talking about curriculum reform and systemic problems in education for quite some time in this Parliament? Ian Gray, Tavish Scott, Liz Smith, in debate after debate after debate, warning for years of concerns from the teaching profession. Chiefly, that Education Scotland and the SQA are not just the byproduct of politically misguided judgments, but on occasion, the cause of them. And if you don't believe me, ask the hundreds of people who protested outside this very Parliament last summer when the exams fiasco marked down their grades in a system designed to do right by them did anything but that. Anything but that. Now, the last OECD review into the curriculum for excellence in 2015 raised serious concerns about the complexity of layers and dimensions of the system. It raised existential questions about how comprehensible the CFE actually was. In 2017, this Parliament called for the inspection and policy functions of Education Scotland to be separated. And what came of that? Nothing. In 2019, the Education Committee of this Parliament raised more serious concerns about the role of education, and it highlighted gaps in its knowledge of the challenges facing our schools and the implementation of the curriculum itself. This was a system designed to offer choice, flexibility and freedom to schools, but instead was often misunderstood and resulted in a delivery so variable that equity and fairness were far from its defining principles. And last year, well, where do we start? The shared frustration of MSPs right across the spectrum cannot be hidden at the sheer arrogance of the SQA and its approach to last year's exams fiasco. We only did what we were asked to do, they said. Well, I asked for an outright apology from them to Scotland's young people, and no such apology was offered. You know, it takes some guts, though, to admit that there may be faults in the system. And I will give Mr. Swinney some credit. In 2019, a second review was commissioned, but its remit was expanded to cover a full review of broad general education. But what happened on that day and on that vote? The government resisted. Of course it did, but it was thankfully defeated, as has been the case on many education issues over this term. Because education is one of those things which unusually unites the opposition, especially one in a minority parliament. But the reason this OECD report is so vital is because it does two things. One, it will shine a light on the fault lines in our education system. And we all know that reform is not possible if you do not know what you're reforming or why. But secondly, it allows the public to decide for themselves if this government's track record in education is one worthy of another 5 years. But here's the problem, folks, because the first of those objectives must be scaring the daylights out of this government. And the second, well, we won't know until days after the public have cast their ballot. Call me a cynic, Cabinet Secretary, but it reeks, which is why my amendment today is so crucial. And I ask colleagues once again to send a strong message to this government. We won't be having it. If he wants to be judged on his record, here's a big silver platter being handed to him. A report which no doubt will extol the virtues of his track record. But judging by the First Minister's woeful response today, First Ministers, to fudge the reasons why she wants to bury this report until after the election, how can this Parliament have any confidence in her sincerity? If Keir Bloomer was so wrong in his assertion that the government has stage managed this in a way that prevented the OECD to actually finding out what the opinion of the education community is, why is he making this stuff up, Cabinet Secretary? You said it on the radio this morning. What has he got to win from saying so? Presiding Officer, in closing, parents, teachers and pupils. I'm happy to take an intervention if I get another minute, but I can't. Presiding Officer, let's not beat about the bush with this. Parents, teachers and pupils will see right through this government's lamentable attempts to cover up their scorecard. Because it knows one thing, and one thing only, and that it will shine a light on 14 years of failure, failure to listen and failure to act. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Ian Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we come to the end of this Parliament, I think, as Willie Rennie did, it is worth reflecting on what Parliament was saying about these issues at its start. Then the government were going to reorganise the governance of school education in their flagship education bill. Now, of course, that flagship bill sank without trace and took the governance review with it, except for the creation of regional improvement collaboratives, which, to be honest, seemed to have troubled the lives of teachers, pupils, parents or educational policy very little in the meantime. The review certainly... Very quick.
John Swinney.
Mr Gray has mentioned regional improvement collaboratives. Does he recognise that a source of a great amount of the learning that's now available has been put together through regional improvement collaboratives? And does he believe that... Is he comfortable associating himself with the criticism of hard-working public servants in the Liberal Democrat motion today?
Ian Gray.
Well, let me come to the criticism of the national bodies, which is what Mr Swinney refers to, because the review, certainly glided by those national bodies, Education Scotland and the SQA, they sailed serenely on 4 years ago, untouched. And in the meantime, in our schools, the curriculum narrowed, with pupils taking exams in fewer and fewer subjects, especially in those schools serving our more deprived communities. Indeed, some subjects reached the point of almost disappearing from the curriculum, some modern languages, for example. The practice of teaching 2, 3, or even sometimes 4 different levels of course in a single class became systemic, not for any good educational reason, but as a way of managing limited resources, in particular, not having enough teachers. The number of pupils identified as requiring additional support soared, while the actual additional support plummeted. So where were those key educational bodies, Education in Scotland and the SQA, when this was going on? Frankly, missing in action. In repeated appearances before the Education Committee of this Parliament, they firstly denied that these problems existed at all. They then told us that they don't actually know how widespread multi-level teaching is, or whether subjects are being squeezed out of the curriculum. They told us that they're not really sure whether our children are being taught in a 3-year plus 3-year model or a 2 plus 2 plus 2 curricular model, and they couldn't tell us whether that matters either. Meanwhile, the SQA continue to assess courses with designated teaching hours which cannot actually be fitted into the Curriculum for Excellence timetable. And then, of course, when the pandemic hit, teachers who, yes, did a heroic job to move to remote learning virtually overnight were left for months without leadership from Education Scotland to support these efforts. The Cabinet Secretary talks about the Education Scotland reviews of remote learning in the second lockdown. But that's right, but those are reviews mostly of what everyone else is doing to make remote learning work. They're not what Education Scotland is doing. And meanwhile, as Jamie Green said, the SQA ignored months of advice that they were designing a certification model which was an accident waiting to happen. And indeed, it happened. And we seem to have learned so little. Only today, we saw yet another iteration of SQA advice this morning, months after exams were cancelled for the second time, with time running out yet again and teachers having been saying for many weeks they needed this information earlier. And it was this Parliament, seized of the seriousness of these issues prior to the pandemic, and without confidence in Education Scotland or the SQA to even recognise these problems, never mind fix them, that forced the Cabinet Secretary to the review. And now we discover that although their work is in his hands, he intends to use the pandemic as an excuse to deny this Parliament sight of their findings. That is not good enough, and the performance of Education Scotland and the SQA has not been good enough either. It is not gratuitous to say that clearly this afternoon. It is absolutely necessary.
Thank you. I now call on Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Liberal Democrats for bringing this issue to debate. I'm certainly glad to have the opportunity today in particular to expand on the calls I made last week for the management board of the SQA to be replaced. Nothing we are raising this afternoon is new to the government or to either agency. We only need to look back at the Education Committee's damning 2017 reports to see how extensively these problems have been detailed before. In the course of those inquiries, we found unclear guidance, poor quality exam papers, onerous workloads imposed on teachers, and an ivory tower culture at both agencies. Trust between the teaching profession and the SQA had already broken down long before last year's grading debacle. The Exams Authority isn't seen as a partner or a support. It's seen by teachers as an antagonist. This is a problem with management culture at the SQA, a management that pre-pandemic appeared far too often to be preoccupied by its international business work rather than focusing on addressing the serious concerns raised by Parliament and by the teaching profession. While some progress was made in reining in the deeply questionable regular business class travel and luxury hotel stays of senior staff, I don't consider the issues that were revealed by whistleblowers to be fully resolved, and I expect the authority to detail a new approach long before such international travel once again becomes a possibility. Back at home, though, the SQA's failures have been laid bare by the pandemic. Last year's grading system was a scandal. Over 75,000 pupils saw their grades downgraded for no other reason than their postcode. I'm proud of the role that the Scottish Greens played in having those grades restored to the levels that pupils actually deserve. The scandal of that grading shambles wasn't just the results, though. It was the SQA and the Scottish Government's utter unwillingness to listen to concerns or to demonstrate even the most basic standards of transparency. Many of us warned for months of exactly what was to transpire. This Parliament twice demanded to see the algorithm. We were rebuffed. This was a disaster that was completely avoidable. And it wasn't just last year. Despite a period of school closures being one of the most predictable outcomes for this year, I found in January the SQA hadn't scenario planned for it. This lack of preparation nearly a year into the pandemic is scandalous. Public confidence in the SQA is all but non-existent. That's why I've asked for the resignations of the current Board of Management. In their place, I've proposed a board structure which would see the SQA overseen by those qualified in education and those directly impacted by its delivery. That means the majority of members should be GTCS registered teachers or lecturers. Seats should be reserved for teachers' unions, a head teacher, a member of the Scottish Youth Parliament, and a parent or carer. I say this without any personal animosity to current SQA board members, one of which I would call a friend, but it's a damning indictment of education governance in Scotland that there are more management consultants than GTCS registered educators on the board of our National Qualifications Agency. By reforming the board into one that properly represents Scottish education, we can start to rebuild trust between the SQA and those they're meant to serve. That can only be the start of a process, though. To round off, Willie Rennie fairly mentions how the Greens voted during a Liberal Democrat debate in 2017. I'm prepared to hold my hands up and say I called that one wrong. Given that it came so soon after the Education Committee's damning reports, I wanted to give both agencies and the Scottish Government an opportunity to respond and to demonstrate their willingness to change. My trust was misplaced. They've not done so. Having spent the 4 years since relentlessly investigating, questioning and debating the performance of both of these agencies, I'm content in the closing weeks of this Parliament with the role that I and my party have played pushing for change. So today the Greens will support the motion and both opposition amendments. For Education Scotland and the SQA, the time's up. Scotland's pupils, teachers and the public at large deserve so much better than what these agencies have delivered. This afternoon, Parliament will deliver our verdict and it's incumbent on the Government to respect that and to act. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I must say to members, we are tight for time and ask all members henceforth to stick to their allotted time. And I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Liz Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's no doubt that teachers, pupils and parents have had the most difficult year due to the COVID-19 pandemic, a year like no other and one I hope we're moving out of gradually. The Liberal Democrat motion makes very serious criticism of the action or inaction, as they see it, of education bodies, the Scottish Qualifications Authority and Education Scotland. Presiding Officer, as a member of the Education Committee, I'm aware of dissatisfaction with these bodies. They are far from perfect and it would be hypocritical of me to defend them at every level. The committee has heard empirical evidence that communication from both organisations with teaching staff and by extension parents and pupils has been poor during the pandemic and pre-pandemic. However, I do think the Liberal Democrat motion and opposition amendments are extreme and extremely unhelpful. They completely ignore the unprecedented challenge these organisations have been up against for almost a year now during COVID-19. The Deputy First Minister made clear that lessons needed to be learned from initial awarding in 2020, which, as we know, was unsuccessful, to say the least. And that's why swift action was taken to commission the rapid review of awarding grades. The distress caused to many pupils throughout Scotland through the use of an algorithm for awarding grades was unacceptable, and that was quickly acknowledged by the government and the education bodies. Presiding Officer, we've moved on and hopefully lessons have been learned. The provision of online and remote learning continues to improve during this second lockdown. I'm aware of that from feedback from my own constituency, as I'm sure others are too. In a survey of over 12,000 parents by Education Scotland, most parents said they have had helpful communication about arrangements for remote learning, which is encouraging to hear. Considerable work has been going on throughout the pandemic. Education Scotland digital officers have delivered 134 webinars for more than 7,500 practitioners. In addition, Education Scotland has provided a named contact for every head teacher in Scotland, allowing head teachers a single point of contact. The SQA are mindful of last year's experience and I'm optimistic that communication with teachers will be quicker and more transparent. Cabinet Secretary has outlined the many areas in which proactive support has been offered to teaching staff this year. Presiding Officer, there's no doubt about the additional burden home learning is placing on many of our children and their families, and of course teachers, many struggling to homeschool their own children while teaching online. But it's important to stress that the operational responsibility for schools lies with local authorities, and they've received considerable additional funding from the Scottish Government. A further £40 million has been awarded to help councils implement safety mitigations for the return to school, aligned with clinical advice, in addition to £60 million of additional investment in education recovery, which includes employing more teachers, classroom support staff and facilities management. Turning to the OECD review, this was undertaken to help us to better understand how the curriculum has been implemented across the country after a committee inquiry recommendation. Following the 2020 SQA exam results, the Scottish Government asked the OECD to expand this work to have a deeper focus on assessment and qualifications approaches in the senior phase. Officials have been working with the OECD to scope the additional work on assessment and qualifications. The additional work will be aligned with the current OECD review, and a comparative paper will be published later in the summer 2021, following the publication of the CFV review report in June 2021. The Scottish Government had to extend the timetable that's available to carry out the review due to the extra work that's been asked to undertake. It's also had to acknowledge the constraints under which the OECD is operating due to the effects of the pandemic. Whether that enables the OECD to formulate interim thoughts in advance of the 2021 election is for the OECD to determine. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, throughout this pandemic, the Scottish Government have made education a priority, particularly as we plan the route map out of lockdown. We're grateful to our hard-working, dedicated teaching professionals for intense work to plan, organise and deliver learning. Many parents now appreciate the skills needed to do the job as they grapple with teaching their children at home. This virus will be beaten and schools will return fully to intensify our efforts to achieve excellence and equity for all of Scotland's children. Thank you.
Thank you. Liz Smith to be followed by Alec Rowley.
Thank you. I think what's very telling about this debate is the fact that, minus the reference to the pandemic, it's a debate that the opposition parties have had several times in recent years. And with that in mind, I want to remind members of the considerable volume of evidence which was taken at the Education Committee between 2016 and 2017, through which it became very clear indeed that many teachers had serious issues with the education agencies, principally Education Scotland and SQA. And that evidence was presented at the same time as John Swinney made it abundantly clear when responding to a poor inspection report about the education being delivered across one particular local authority, that when it came to improving standards in Scottish schools, he said, the status quo is not an option. I wholeheartedly agreed with him then, and if he repeated it now, I would agree with him again. And I agreed with him then for two reasons. Standards in our schools were not as good as they should be. That was clearly shown by several of the indices for basic literacy and numeracy. And secondly, too many teachers were telling us that their trust in Education Scotland and SQA had diminished. Now, that is not a helpful situation at any time, but especially during the major curriculum reform of CFE, which, incidentally, John Swinney acknowledged was a bit of a mystery tour, and certainly not during a pandemic when the pressures are even greater. Now, I don't think John Swinney at the time felt that the committee evidence was as balanced as he would have liked. But, nonetheless, he promised an education bill, which at the time, Nicola Sturgeon said would be the most radical change to how schools were run since devolution. It was not only lauded as a flagship bill, but as a promise to change the status quo. And I can recall conversations with the Cabinet Secretary in which he seemed utterly determined to improve standards, and I believed him on that, and during which he offered to engage with the education spokesman in each party about what we would like to see. And I have here my submission to him at the time. And it is abundantly clear that one of the recommendations to the Scottish Government was to reform the education agencies, starting with the decoupling of the policy and inspectorate roles of Education Scotland on the basis that it should not be judge and jury. The education bill, as we know, was shelved in June 2018, the reason being given was that the necessary changes could be made without the legislative reform, despite the fact, I have to say, that very little data was available to make that judgment. How Mr. Swinney must now rue the ditching of that bill, because it seems highly likely to me that the current OECD report is going to reveal some things that the Scottish Government doesn't like. Otherwise, why would you hold it back? And so I think the opposition parties are quite right to challenge the Scottish Government about this delay, given how thorough and helpful the previous OECD report was in highlighting the problems which have to be addressed. This time, it is absolutely essential that there is some meaningful action. Of course, what is at the centre of this whole issue is the confusion over the lines of accountability, an issue which the Education Committee highlighted very strongly in its report in 2017, recommending that this was addressed without delay. And to be fair to the Cabinet Secretary, he was quick to say at the time that the buck stops with him for education policy. But the trouble is, Cabinet Secretary, that teachers on the ground don't see it that way just now. They see continued confusion, obfuscation and lack of transparency at the heart of government and education agencies, with the result that there is ongoing mistrust. Now, I distinctly remember telling John Swinney in 2016 that the problem schools have been encountering were not caused by teachers or by pupils, but by civil servants and education agencies, with the result that education had become too much of a political football. Deputy Presiding Officer, no one at all would like to have been in John Swinney's shoes during this pandemic. I think he's had an incredibly difficult job. But neither must the pandemic be used for an excuse as to what is wrong with the governance of Scottish education. There are clear signs of problems. There were clear signs of problems many years ago, and nothing has been done to counter them.
Thank you. I call Alec Rowley to be followed by Claire Adams.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would ask the Cabinet Secretary, when concluding, touches on this point of the OECD report and why that report, if he does indeed have that report, why that report has not been published. Because we all, I think, would assign up to in this chamber the belief that the greatest gift you could give any child within a modern society is that of education. And therefore, I would hope there was unity in wanting to strive forward and ensure that all children get the best education that they possibly can. I think I also take on board Mr. Swinney's point that he is concerned about the criticism of civil servants and these national bodies. But the truth is that these national bodies, there has been major question marks over these national bodies and their ability to actually deliver that education that we want to see in Scotland. Those doubts have been there over many years. The curriculum for excellence and the way that it was introduced and the failings, the major failings that were there for everyone to see around these national bodies. There's also been concerns that as school budgets have been getting cut, these national bodies have been grown and grown in numbers, grown in budgets, but that not being reflected in the levels of support that is coming back to teachers and to schools. So I do think I do hope Mr. Swinney will pick those points up. I think they are genuine concerns. I would also ask the Deputy First Minister that when schools do begin to open up more fully, and we're seeing the P1 and P3 starting on Monday, that he does listen to teachers, to staff in schools, and to the trade unions. Because the one thing I know personally, because I have family members that are teachers, but the one thing I know for talking to many teachers is the pressure that teachers have been working under throughout this entire period of this virus has been immense. Once we had the first lockdown and kids came back through the lockdown, there was, I'm told, a marked difference even in the behaviour of children coming back into the schools and then having to cope with new rules, wearing face coverings, etc. So the pressures have been massive. And then to go back into lockdown again and the pressures on teachers, particularly, I think, you know, many teachers have their own families at home and they're therefore trying to support their own families in the middle of lockdown and support others. So if nothing else, these teachers have come through a very difficult period and they have earned, in my opinion, the right to be listened to. And they should be listened to, and the teaching unions should be listened to. So where there are concerns, genuine concerns, over safety and virus transmissions, all efforts must be made to put proper alternatives in place to avoid further interruptions to education, but to ensure that everyone that works in our schools does so in a safe way. I appreciate Presiding Officer, that this is a short debate and I'm running out of time, but I would say that I genuinely believe that everyone in here wants every child to get the best opportunities, to get a good education, and that's what we need to do, pull together. And finally, regardless of what's said to do today, I believe after the election there will have to be a review of all these national bodies and a review of how we deliver education. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Claire Adamson, who will be the last open debate speaker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think Mr. Green it was said that he felt these debates were a bit like Groundhog Day in his time in the Parliament and the education portfolio. I have to say, as someone who's married to a retired teacher, I have lived through the introduction of 5 to 14, higher still, and curriculum for excellence, all of which were not without controversy, all of which were under intense scrutiny, and all of which grabbed the headlines throughout their time and my time as a councillor and MSP. That being said, we must remember that despite talk of a complete failure here, we still have a good performing education system. We have more pupils achieving 5 or more hires than S5 than ever before. We have more positive destinations for young people. And ADIS just recently were, before the COVID hit, were highlighting how we have a huge fall in the number of exclusions in school, which is all to be welcome and all good. That being said, COVID-19 has had a massive impact on our society, our learning and teaching, and our schools communities are no exception. Indeed, a year ago, it would have been impossible to imagine that our schools would have had to move to home learning, our exam diet would have been cancelled for 2 consecutive years, or that we would be in a second lockdown. And the impact on our young people and school communities is we're only just beginning to understand the extent of it. And in all of that, we are all striving. Everyone in this chamber wants excellence and equity for our children and young people. And in striving for that, we know societal inequalities and individual personal challenges have only been exacerbated by COVID, putting immense pressure on children, young people and their families and carers. I'm pleased that after the last period of school building closures, the Scottish Government commissioned an equity audit published in January to better understand the impact on children's learning and health and wellbeing, focusing particularly on the disadvantaged students. Since the start of the pandemic, the Scottish Government's funding has led to an additional 1,400 teachers and over 200 support staff being appointed. And new funding can be used to recruit further staff, which might include teachers, classroom assistants, administrative staff, homeschool link workers or other support workers, as well as resources that families and schools need to support home learning, including additional digital devices where there are any remaining unmet needs in home learning resources. I'm incredibly grateful to our hardworking, dedicated teaching professionals for their intense work to plan and organise and deliver learning. Before COVID, the Scottish Government had commissioned the internationally renowned OECD to undertake an independent review of curriculum for excellence to help us better understand how the curriculum was being implemented across the country. And we should not forget, it's still a relatively new curriculum, with only in the last few years, pupils finishing in senior phase who had started under curriculum for excellence in primary schools. We couldn't have envisaged the impact of COVID would have on all of our teaching and learning, but also on that commissioned work. Nor could we have predicted the impact of the awarding of the 2020 exam diet to the extent that it did happen. The Deputy First Minister made clear that lessons needed to be learned from awarding in 2020 and swift action was taken. The Scottish Government also expanded the OECD remit to include the wider issues to do with the broad general education and senior phase and the articulation between the two. I still remain unconvinced that there is a disadvantage to observations about subject choice, because at the end of the day, it's the outcome of pupils that matter. And as we can see, more and more pupils are going on to modern apprenticeships, further and higher education. Scottish Government has also had to acknowledge the constraints under which the OECD is operating due to the effects of the pandemic. In September, the Deputy
Ms. Adamson, you are over your time. I'll have to call you to draw your remarks to a close.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's very hard to monitor when you're at home. But I think this motion puts the cart before the horse. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. We now move to closing speeches, and I call Daniel Johnson. 4 minutes, Mr. John.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Let me begin by agreeing with the Deputy First Minister. I have no doubt that there has been a huge amount of hard work going on by a great number of people, both within the SQA and Education Scotland. I have no doubt that much of that work has been useful. But the two key central points that are entirely inescapable in this debate have been set out on the one hand, Ross Grier and Liz Smith, and that the issues with these institutions are not new, they're not confined to the pandemic, they are long-standing and have been revisited by this Parliament on a number of occasions. And quite frankly, we are reaching the limit at which we can keep having these debates with no action coming out of them. But the second key issue is that there is a pattern of outcomes, a pattern of results, which are a direct cause of these institutions, which we cannot be supported. And they were well set out by Jamie Green and by Willie Rennie. We cannot ignore the pattern of what has happened over the last 10 years with the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence, starting out with the 20,000 pages of guidance that Willie Rennie pointed to, that led to huge confusion amongst the teaching profession and undoubtedly hampered the rollout of Curriculum for Excellence. And we need to actually talk plainly, because Curriculum for Excellence has been bedeviled with these ongoing issues. And while many of them have been resolved, we still have the lingering issues that, while this was meant to be a broad change in approach, linking across disciplines, that what we've seen is a fudging of disciplines, a fudging of boundaries, that we have a lack of clarity, that there's been too much emphasis, a requirement on teachers to reconstruct a curriculum for themselves, and that there's an overarching checkbox approach rather than a broad change in doctrine, which was supposed to be ushered in by this. Nor can we ignore the issues that have been with the examinations themselves. We know about the problems with multi-level teaching. We know about the issues that there were associated with the introduction of National Fives and the very significant changes that had to occur as a result of that. And the truth is, when you bury into these things, the problems with these institutions become very clear indeed. When the Education Committee at the beginning of this Parliament looked at many of these issues, neither Education Scotland nor the SQA could point to who had made the decisions regarding the deliverability of those examinations. And that, again, that lack of transparency, that lack of clarity as to who is responsible, I think is a theme that you see throughout these issues as we examine them. If you look more recently at the problems with the algorithm, we continue to have that lack of transparency from the SQA. They changed the methodology fundamentally, removing the final link of going back to schools to check on those results. And they never published the algorithm. This simply is not an approach that we can tolerate in our education system. We need transparency. We need institutions that have the trust of the education system, that have the trust of teachers and that have the trust of parents. Quite simply, these institutions have lost that trust, and we can carry on no further in this state of affairs. And finally, we come to the OECD report. Report which hopefully will provide answers, but we won't know what those answers are, certainly not before the election. And the election is supposed to be the opportunity for the electorate to make informed decisions. And on education, the most important subject area that this Parliament will look at, and certainly according to the First Minister, the electorate are not going to be able to make an informed decision because that report will not be published, despite the fact that it will be sitting on the desks of ministers. So for those reasons, we cannot support the government motion, amendment to this motion, and we must support the Liberal Democrat motion, because we need to reform our education system, we need to reform the SQA and Education Scotland. Thank you.
Call Oliver Mundell, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate has pretty much summed up 14 years of SNP education policy failure. Not only is this government wasting time and energy on plotting an illegal referendum before Christmas of this year, but it now seems that any spare energy they've got left is being expended hiding the truth at all costs. Because let us make no mistake, if they had got a glowing report from the OECD, we would be having a debate about it in this chamber, and at the very least, it would have been leaked to the press. But instead, it sits buried under all the other damning documents this Parliament has demanded be published on the Cabinet Secretary's desk. The claim that that education is this government's number one priority is laughable and no longer holds any credibility. And at the heart of the problem is the Cabinet Secretary, who has failed to get a grip of any of the key issues and has simply opted at every turn for the path of least resistance, rather than demanding the change so badly needed to restore our once world-leading education system. And it doesn't escape my attention today that many members who've served in this Parliament for a long time recognise the repeat failures and a continued choice on the Cabinet Secretary's part to push these issues further and further down the road. And all the while, our young people are being let down. We have all of the essential ingredients there for a world-leading system. A dedicated workforce, committed young people, parents, carers, and a will in this Parliament to work together. We have seen this once again during the pandemic, where many schools and individual teachers have gone above and beyond in exceptionally difficult circumstances. The only thing missing in all of this is the SNP. Indeed, I have lost count of how many times this government has lost votes on education, with the rest of the Parliament, despite our political differences, uniting to call for action. No one who has sat on this Parliament's Education Committee or followed those proceedings can have any confidence in Education Scotland or the SQA. There seems to be a kind of pact in place that they will let the Scottish Government off the hook when it comes to substandard outcomes, in a return for a free pass to mark their own homework and to excuse away their own role in events. Over the last 5 years, I have visited almost every school in my constituency, with only the pandemic preventing me from completing the list. In every school, I've seen the problem. Teachers and young people coming up against a system that speaks in sound bites and buzzwords, which thinks it knows better and which ultimately does not seem to grasp the challenges on the ground. There is clear confusion, as many members have pointed out, over the lines of accountability and who is actually making some of the key decisions and judgment calls. I'm personally alarmed at the continued failings when it comes to ESM provision. It's progress that the Cabinet Secretary now seems to recognise that there's a gap between the rhetoric and reality, but as every single person on the coalface knows, that's been the case for years and nothing is being done. Right across the education system, the very organisations that are there to help raise standards and ensure equity and excellence are so detached from reality, it's hard to see how they can ever do their job effectively. I believe that's why, as my colleague Liz Smith and others have pointed out, teachers have lost faith in these key organisations, and we just cannot accept that. That's why, Presiding Officer, if we are serious about getting things right for our young people, we cannot let things slip into the next Parliament. We must own the issues and face them head on. The pandemic, rather than being a convenient excuse to hit the pause button, is a call to action that has highlighted the weakness at the centre of the system, and we need to do something about it. The Cabinet Secretary needs to do something about it. It's not enough just to wish the problems away. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call John Swinney, Cabinet Secretary, 4 minutes.
President Officer, one of the points that Daniel Johnson made, I think, just does not stand up to any scrutiny whatsoever. And Mr. Johnson said that he acknowledged that public servants had done a great deal of work in supporting the delivery of education during remote learning in the agencies in Education Scotland and the SQA that are the subject of criticism in Willie Rennie's motion today. But Mr Johnson has indicated he intends to go on to vote for that. And I just think it leaves a pretty bad taste for people who've worked really hard to try to support the education system, as teachers and local authority officials have done around the country, for them to be given a kick in the teeth by Parliament this afternoon. Which is, yes, I will give way to you, Mr Rennie.
William Rennie.
It's a characteristic of this government that whenever they're under attack, they always use public servants to defend their policy failures. And this is another example of that. We in no way criticise individuals. We criticise the organisation, and the Minister should accept that.
Well, John Swinney.
I think that's just the pathetic kind of behaviour that we get from Mr Rennie and from his colleague Mr Cole Hamilton on a regular basis, because we have got public servants in these organisations who've worked very, very hard during the pandemic, and the first part of your motion, Mr Rennie, sticks the boot into those public servants, and I will not associate the government with that type of shabby behaviour, and the Liberal Democrats know all about shabby behaviour this week, if I may say so. But, at the heart of this, I'm going to have to close the debate. On some of the substantive choices here, Mr Rowley put fair points to me about the funding for school education. And I've boosted school education funding by sending money directly to schools for 5 years in pupil equity funding, giving head teachers control over the budgets at their disposal. Mr Rowley then attacks me for funding the national agencies. If I hadn't funded the national agencies, there would not be a digital network in place that allows every single school pupil in Scotland to have access to a digital account that enables them to access remote learning. So that's what investment in the national agencies has brought. In addition to that, Mr. Gray laid into the SQA for all of the preparations for the assessment in 2021. One of the recommendations of the Priestley Review was that the SQA should bring together a stakeholder group within the education system involving professional associations, College of Scotland, the directors of education working with the SQA. They're called the National Qualifications 2021 Group, and they are the authors of the guidance that is available to the education system. So the SQA have not gone away off into some ivory tower to make it up themselves. They've been working, as the Priestley recommendations said they should do, with the wider education system. Now, I put those 2 points on the record to indicate that I think some of this debate has been, frankly, gratuitous. Now, drawing my remarks to a close, Claire Adamson hit the nail on the head, and so did Oliver Mundell, if I may say so, if I can get through the persistent personal attacks that Mr Mundell makes on me in parliamentary debates. It's part of his character now in Parliament. But as I work my way through all of that, Claire Adamson and Mr Mundell made exactly the right points. What has been the effect on outcomes as a consequence of the SNP government? And what's been the effect? The effect has been that more young people are getting better qualifications over the 14 years of this government. Mr Mundell shakes his head. I suggest he goes away. I certainly will give way.
Briefly, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, President Officer. I cannot believe that Mr Swinney can look young people in the eye from deprived communities and say that under his government they've had a fair crack at the whip. I don't believe that. And hiding behind selectively quoted statistics just does not cut it.
I suggest Mr Mundell goes and acquaints himself with some of the statistics, because on attainment of qualifications at 5 hires, at 1 hire from areas of deprivation, of positive destinations achieved, young people are doing better today than they did when this government came to office. That's the record I am going to take to the streets of this country on May the 6th, and I look forward to Mr Mundell and his colleagues getting the hammering they deserve at that occasion.
I now call on Beatrice Wishart to wind up this debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, there's a lot to be proud of in Scottish education. It's been alarming to see what teachers and learners have had to endure during this pandemic, and let's not forget the challenges in parents and family life. But it's also been inspiring to see what teachers and learners have achieved. Ian Gray rightly referred to their heroic efforts. To say teachers have stepped up doesn't do it justice. For many, going above and beyond, as Oliver Mundell highlighted, was a habit they were already accustomed to. Whatever the ask and whenever the call, teachers have worked flat out to give pupils the best education possible. In that light,
the failing national educational infrastructure has become all the more clear. When they were needed most, both of the Education Secretary's quangos left teachers, pupils and parents in the lurch. Children and young people should be at the top of the priority list, without question. And yet, minutes after the publication of last year's exam results, the Scottish Government's own documents established that pupils from poorer areas were penalised the most. The SQA told the Education Secretary about those outcomes the week before. No minutes were taken at that meeting, but we know how it ended. There was no counterbalance or challenge. Somehow, results that actively and unfairly downgraded pupils, based simply on the school they went to, were agreed as acceptable. That was a critical meeting, a chance to pull the plug, but they pressed publish. And it's hard to think about the distress pupils, parents and teachers experienced as a result. Incredibly, on reflection, the SQA seemed to think that in fact theirs was a job well done, because they had completed the ministerial brief and had delivered what the Education Secretary asked for. In the short review that followed, Professor Mark Priestley found a perception that the organisation was remote and resistant to working with stakeholders. He found that, and I quote, there has been an erosion of trust / confidence in SQA amongst teachers and young people, end quote. I asked Professor Priestley whether he thought fulfilling the ministerial brief was the SQA's primary aim. He answered yes. There is no doubt the SQA would prefer to appease ministers and keep the cosy arrangement going rather than serve the interests of Scotland's learners. Ross Grier and Liz Smith referred to previous parliamentary debates and evidence taken by the Education Committee in 2016-2017 and the concerns then about agency accountability. Education Scotland has been missing throughout, and Scottish Liberal Democrats have long been concerned about their ability to do the job they've been set. There is a fundamental conflict of interest at their heart. They set the Scottish Government's education policy at the same time as holding it accountable. We aren't the only ones who don't trust what's going on. Only 28% of Education Scotland's own employees said they have confidence in its leadership. And now Scottish Liberal Democrat research has revealed that they have ministerial approval to meddle with the report that's supposed to guide improvement and change. Presiding Officer, these agencies have been remote and unaccountable for too long. This must change. As Daniel Johnson said, there must be transparency in the system. Scotland's children and young people deserve better. They deserve the highest possible standard of education so they can all reach their full potential.
Thank you very much. And that concludes the debate on education. And it is now time to move on to the next item of business.